Hey, if you're joining us now, we'll get started in a minute, just giving it time. Thank you. All right. Hello, everyone. Welcome and good evening. Thanks for joining us virtually tonight. My name is Maddie Walters, and on behalf of Harvard Bookstore, I'm pleased to introduce you to this virtual event with Deborah Spar presenting her new book, Work, Mate, Marry, Love, in conversation with Jamie Metzl. Through virtual events like tonight, Harvard Bookstore continues to bring authors and their work to you and others in our community during these challenging times. Every week, we're hosting events here on our Zoom, and as always, our event schedule appears on our website at harvard.com/events, where you can sign up for our weekly email newsletter and browse our shelves from home. This evening's discussion will conclude with some time for your questions. If you have a question for our speakers at any time tonight, go to the Q&A box at the bottom of the screen, and we'll get through as many as we can. In the chat box during this presentation, you'll see a link to purchase tonight's book online. All sales through this link support Harvard Bookstore, so thank you for your support during this trying time for community spaces like your local bookstores. You will also find a link to donate in the chat box. Your purchases and contributions make this virtual author series possible, and now more than ever, supports the future of a landmark independent bookstore. Thank you for tuning in. In support of our authors and the incredible staff of booksellers at Harvard Bookstore, we sincerely appreciate your support, now and always. And finally, as you may have experienced in virtual gatherings these last few months, technical issues may arise. If they do, we'll do our best to resolve them quickly. Thank you for your patience and understanding. And now, I'm pleased to introduce tonight's speakers. Deborah Spar is the MBA Class of 1952 Professor of Business Administration at Harvard Business School, and the Senior Associate Dean of Harvard Business School Online. Prior to Harvard, she served as the President of Barnard College and President and CEO of Lincoln Center for the Performing Arts. Her previous work includes Ruling the Waves, The Baby Business, and Wonder Woman, Sex, Power, and the Quest for Perfection. Jamie Metzl is a technology and healthcare futurist, geopolitical expert, and media commentator. He is also Senior Fellow of the Atlantic Council, faculty member at Singularity University, and the founder and chair of the global social movement, One Shared World. He is the author of the historical novel, The Depths of the Sea, the genetic thrillers, Genesis Code and Eternal Sonata, and Hacking Darwin, Genetic Engineering and the Future of Humanity. Tonight, they'll be discussing her new book, Work, Mate, Marry, Love, How Machines Shape Our Human Destiny, which was praised by author and podcast host Patrick McGinnis as a fresh and incisive take on how technology has long shaped our relationships with work and with each other. Deborah Spar has mined the past to show us where we are going next. I am so pleased to turn things over to tonight's speakers, Deborah and Jamie. The digital podium is all yours.
Terrific. All right. Well, thank you so much, Maddie. And it's really, I think, for Deb and for me, just a pleasure and an honor to be here with you. Our independent bookstores play such an important role in maintaining our ecosystem of independent thought. And with everybody home and hopefully home and quarantined, these kinds of conversations are really more important than ever. So thank you, Maddie and Harvard Bookstore. Thank you, everybody, for being here. And we certainly hope that you will support Harvard Bookstore. And the best way to support a bookstore is to buy a book. And lucky for everybody, I've actually read this book, and it is a just phenomenal, fantastic, great, wonderful, spectacular, terrific, excellent book. In other words, I really highly recommend it. And my job here, it's like when there's like, you go for sushi, there's like the fish and there's like the little ball of rice. I'm just the little ball of rice. Deborah and her great book, that is the sushi. And so my job is to start out with some really tough gotcha questions, like what inspired you to write this book?
Well, thank you, Jamie. Thank you for doing this. Thank you for comparing me to a piece of sushi, although I'm not quite sure what to do with that, but thank you. So the story of how I wrote this book is, I think it's the story of like how I write most of my books. It just kind of evolved. It wasn't really the book I had planned to write, but I've had this sort of interesting, at least to me, sort of dual path in both my professional life and my writing life. So I've written a bunch of books like you have about technology, and mine in particular about sort of how technologies evolve. And I always like thinking about technologies in this broader historical perspective. And then I've done some other books, particularly when I was at Barnard, about women's lives and sexuality and families and love. And it increasingly struck me that those sort of two streams of literature never talk to one another. That the technology literature, with apologies to people like you, tends to be kind of male. You know, it's about building things and breaking things and disrupting things. And the women's literature tends to be sort of softer and about love and family and romance. And if you believe, as I do, and I think you share my beliefs in your books as well, that technology has these huge effects that cut across society, then we need to be bringing these literatures together, and we need to be looking about what happens when these disruptive technologies disrupt love and sex and romance and all that other stuff. And so that was the origin of this book. And, you know, I didn't quite think that I'd go all the way back and, you know, spend so much time looking at the evolution of the plow in 8,000 BC, but that's just kind of where the research took me.
And so I think it's a really great point, because when people think about these issues, they think about all of these new technologies. I mean, you forget even love and sex with robots, but contraception, all of these revolutionary technologies that have come to fruition in many of our lifetimes. But walk us through. I know you have some great stuff in the book on this, but the parallel between technology and our most intimate personal and sexual and relational lives. What do you see as kind of the big quantum historical moments that have led us to here?
So I look in the book at kind of three big chunks of revolutions, if you will. So clearly technology is evolving all the time, but there are moments in history when it evolved faster than others and with more seismic effects. So I go back to what I think most people consider the world's first technological revolution, which was the development of agricultural techniques. So for most of human history, we didn't have agriculture. We were hunters and gatherers and foragers. And then the plow comes along and kind of everything changes. And society as we know it emerges, cities emerge, governments emerge, war emerges. All of that, I argue, was largely as a result of this first technological revolution. Then, like, there's a lot of history, but then the next great technological revolution is the Industrial Revolution, of which people know more about in the 17th and 18th centuries. And then I really fast forward to today, when I think we all realize we're going through the next great technological revolution, which is the information digital computer revolution. And at each of those shifts, I argue, it wasn't just that commerce changed or our economies changed, our most important family structures changed. And so I essentially argue that marriage as we know it, and certainly monogamous marriage and till death do us part marriage, was a creation of the agricultural revolution. It didn't exist before agriculture. And then the nuclear family as we've come to know it, and particularly the division of labor that we now see as sort of normal, where the men are the breadwinner and the women stay home, that was a creation of the Industrial Revolution. And so if you buy the argument up to that point, then when you see as we move into the future and we increasingly use assisted reproductive technologies to create our babies and we meet each other online and we're developing robots to do all kinds of once human tasks, then the family structure as we know it is about to be fundamentally transformed.
Yeah, and it's funny. I mean, my guess is at every point along this historical continuum, most people thought, oh, this is just the way it is. This is the way things have always been. I mean, but I would imagine there are those kinds of inflection points. I mean, in the early stages of the Industrial Revolution where people remembered, oh, it used to be something kind of fundamentally different. And how do we think about managing those things? Because those transitions, because part of so many of us buying into these structures, and like today with kind of traditional marriage, is that people really internalize what you're saying is this is just, and I mean, I say it all the time, and that's how you get to be 52 and single, but these are just fleeting social structures. They've been this way for a little while. They'll change soon. We don't want to get too locked into to any of them. What is it about us that where we have this kind of deep emotional need to want to think of these highly changeable experiences as being eternal? Like with death do us part, it's like it's forever and ever and always.
Yeah, well, I think it's a great question, and it touches on something which is fundamentally normal, that change is hard. We all think we want change, right? And we see this in the management realm as much as in the personal realm. Everybody thinks they want change. But when push comes to shove, like they want change, but they don't want things to be any different from what they've gotten used to. So change is really, really hard, which is, you know, one of the many reasons I think that what we're going through right now, the COVID crisis, is so disturbing on so many levels, because our lives as we've known them have been upended. But putting COVID aside, I think we see that across time, that we want stability. We want tradition, we want legacy. And the book, as you know, because you've read it, the book actually starts sort of in the Victorian period. And one of the things I found most interesting about that was it was really only during the Industrial Revolution that the idea of the future even emerged. Because throughout most of human history, even when we were going through the Agricultural Revolution, change was happening over hundreds and thousands of years. A person during the space of their own lifetime didn't see change. They might see change in their own life, but their lives unfolded structurally the same as their grandparents and great-grandparents. Then in the Victorian period, you could have a person who knew life without railroads, and then knew life with railroads. And that was the first sort of visible, tangible sign. And so the whole idea of a future gets created at that moment. Now, of course, when change is happening so quickly that every one of us has seen rapid technological change in our own lifetimes, even if we're only 10 years old, you know, social media didn't really exist 10 years ago. Now it's taken over. So I think that's one of the reasons that makes us both excited and nervous and anxious, because we don't know what the future is going to hold. We don't know if we're going to fall in love with robots. And that's both exciting and profoundly destabilizing.
Yeah. And I think our brains aren't structured for it. I mean, our brains came to maturity in the savannas of Africa, where we were exactly as you've described, the world didn't really change. It wasn't like, you know, some creature climbed down from a tree and it's like everybody climbed down. I mean, it was a little bit at a time. And, you know, somebody stood up and peered over the grass and got some little advantage over hundreds of thousands of years. So it seems like there's almost this mismatch between the structure of our brains and the speed of change.
No, that's, yeah. Because our brains just haven't evolved that quickly. And, you know, we've all felt it, you know, that we, if you believe the folks who study this, we all still get that sort of fight or run impulse, that cortisol that streams into our brain. That's an ancient impulse.
Yeah.
But it's still there.
Yeah. No, it's just, and yet we can see little glimpses of the future. I mean, we'll get to COVID. Last year, which seems like 10,000 years ago, when I used to have this life where I traveled to other places, and I was in Sweden. And I was at this this restaurant, and I was talking with actually the waitress, and you know, she learned I was from New York. We actually had this nice conversation, and I was just telling her about life in New York. I mean, it got to these issues of marriage and personal life, and it was almost like we were coming from different planets. Like when I explained that, well, there's this pressure that people feel because of marriage, and it was almost like she was living just in a different world. Like, well, we don't do that. You just kind of, you have a partner and the partner is there for a while and maybe you'll have a kid or maybe not, and maybe you'll move on. And then COVID happened. And with COVID, in so many different areas, the way I describe it, it's the future is crashing into the present. These trends that we thought would play out over years and months, or over years and decades, are showing up over really weeks and months. I mean, even these Zoom calls. I mean, it's just like 6 months ago, many people have, at least, I won't pull you into this, of my generation had never done a Zoom call, didn't know what it was. Now we live here. There've been a lot of really interesting articles that I've read about how dating and sex and all these other kinds of things are actually still happening now. Yeah, there's almost a new culture, a new COVID culture, that's integrating technology and quarantine and social norms and human needs. In what ways has our experience of COVID brought into sharper relief some of these mega trends that maybe were going to show up over time? And in what ways has something happened to us that's maybe different from what you might have expected when you were writing the book?
Yeah, well, certainly I don't think any of us, except maybe Bill Gates, you know, anticipated what COVID would be and how it would affect us. But I think I've used the same phrase that you just used, that we're crashing into the future. Yeah. COVID has accelerated everything, and particularly exactly what we're doing right now. You know, the last time I gave a book talk at the Harvard bookstore, I was sitting in the store, surrounded by books, surrounded by human people, you know, signing books. It was wonderful, and I miss it, and I hope we go back to that world. By the same token, in what has it been, 5-6 months, we've kind of moved into this. And not only have book signings and book talks moved online, classrooms, my class, you know, all classes have moved online. We celebrated my mother's 80th birthday online yesterday, as people are doing. People are sitting Shiva online. People are having first communions online. And yes, people are meeting each other online. Is it the same? Absolutely not. But is it something? Yes. And I think, you know, I think there are many things that we will all rush to as soon as we possibly can get off Zoom. But there's many things that we won't rush to. You know, I wish I had been with my mother in person for her 80th birthday, but do I need to be at every board meeting in person? Probably not. Does it mean I have to get on a plane every time? Probably not. It's better for the environment. It's better for the planet. So I think we will never quite come back to where we were before COVID. But I also think, and this is sort of the optimism that strangely runs through this book, I think what spending all this time on Zoom will also underscore for us are what are the things that we must do in person? What are the human interactions that we don't want to give up? And I think we're really seeing this on college campuses. Yeah. You know, it may be that the education online is fine, but the, you know, meeting someone over a cup of coffee has to happen in person. Well, you know, we're still kind of figuring that all out.
Well, you have a racy title of your book and racy content in it. So I'm not going to let you off the hook that easily. So let's talk about dating and relationships and people meeting each other and sex. And how have you seen that changing in this world of COVID? And how do you, let's just say hypothetically, that there'll be a vaccine at some point, let's say a year from now or a year and a half from now, we can say, all right, we've passed through this experience. What do you think stays from this experience that would have been different had we not had it, in terms of relationships and love and sex?
Yeah, well, I figure so. It's not particularly racy at all. In fact, it's the reverse. So I think we're many of us are going to be wary about, you know, close contact with people we don't know. I think in some ways this will be like the AIDS crisis across a broader set of community, that until we feel more confident, just sort of, you know, sort of intimate contact, whether it be sexual contact or just sitting next to people in a crowded theater, I think our wariness has gone up. In terms of the dating, and I have to caveat this by saying I did the research pre-COVID, so what I know is more anecdotal, but people were already doing the vast bulk of their romantic initiation, if you will, online. And so the totally unscientific, but I think highly reliable data source of the New York Times wedding section, you know, reveals that, you know, a third of marriages today are commenced on online dating sites. And whereas as recently as 5 years ago, people were a little sort of coy about that. You know, we met through friends. Now, if you read the wedding announcements, we met on Tinder, we met on Bumble, we met, you know, people, right. This has just become the equivalent of we met at a bar or, you know, our brother-in-law's introduced us. And I think there's a lot that's good about that. There's some data that's suggesting that there's more interracial marriages now because people are meeting other people well outside their own social circles, which tend to be, you know, one race, unfortunately. But there's also some really scary things happening. And it's not, I mean, people of a certain age, including my age, tend to get sort of all, you know, titillated by this and say, oh my God, everybody's having sex online, but they're not. In fact, it's actually the reverse. People are having less sex in the younger generations, and it's asymmetrical in the sense that people who are sort of deemed attractive on online sites tend to be very young, good-looking women and older, rich men. You know, they have great success, but people who are deemed unattractive in both same-sex and you know, heterosexual relationships are actually getting far less access to relationships.
And then there's Amy Webb. Do you know Amy Webb?
No, well,
she's
the
futurist at NYU, and she did this full data analysis of the dating sites. She set up a fake account as a man to do a full analysis of what kinds of pictures did people respond to, how did the data flows work, and she charted it all out using big data analytics. And then she did her analysis of what kind of person who she wanted and had a point system. And anyway, she now has written a book about this. I don't think it's come out yet, but like found this guy. And I mean, it's kind of just interesting, the intersection of these algorithms, technologies, these raw emotions that have been with us, you know, since before we were humans, and just everything moving so quickly. So people having less sex, people more isolated, and that leads us then into the next topic that you tweeted about today, about sex with robots. Before we get to sex with robots, I mean, there are all of these other kind of halfway houses. I mean, we have like little robots, vibrators and things. Now there's haptic suits where people are exploring with teledildonics, where you could be half a world away from your spouse, your lover, whomever, and you each have an outfit on. And so your one movement is reciprocated in that other person's technology. But then robots. And I think that we're all seeing in a kind of a relatively simple way through our relationships with our Alexas and our, I mean, okay, Google just doesn't have as good of a name or a voice, but with Alexas, I mean, I think when people say, well, what was your relationship? Oh, she's hearing me. that, you know, 5 years ago, nobody had a relationship with one of these home voice mechanisms. If you kind of trace the difference between where we were then and where we are now and take it forward 5 years and take it forward 10 years, and we look at all of those Boston Robotics, those little dogs that those mean people kick, but every year the videos get cooler. I mean, you can just realize that the AI is going to get better, the voice is going to get better, the movement is going to get better, and eventually some subset of us are going to develop all kinds of emotional bonds, whether sexual or just straight emotional. How do you see that playing out? I mean, right now we know I'm me and my toaster's my toaster. 100 years from now, it may be a little more blurry. How do you feel?
Well, I hope and suspect that you will still be differentiated from your toaster, even but you just gave us the perfect example. So we're sitting here having this conversation. You say the word Alexa, and this being of some sort is suddenly part of the conversation. Yeah. You know, I think, and I'll confess I'm guilty of this, you know, sort of throwing out the phrase sex with robots, it catches people's attention. Yeah. But I think the sex with robot parts, which will happen, but it's way less interesting than the love with robots or the relationship with robots. And, you know, when I'm talking about some of these topics when we could back in the live classroom, I would always sort of throw out that provocative line, you know, we're going to fall in love with robots, and everybody looks at me like I'm an idiot. And then I say, all right, let's do the thought exercise. You know, how many of you at this moment have your smartphone physically on your body?
Yeah.
And it's kind of everyone. And yeah. How many of you went to bed last night with that smartphone in the bed, or at least said, you know, interacted with it as the last thing before you went to bed? And you just see how the logic unfolds. So I don't think the future is us sort of, you know, rushing into bed with robotic beings. That will happen on the margins, and there's always been, you know, fringe elements of society that are, you know, much more sexually, you know, exploring. But I think what will happen is we're gonna start talking to these machines in our house, like you just did, and they will answer back, and we will, and these are essentially the Model Ts of robots. This is the super first generation. And we will, within our lifetimes, start bringing smart beings, smart computers into our lives.
Yeah.
In ways that become not sexual necessarily, and maybe not even romantic, but certainly emotional. The other, you know, mind test I always ask people is, you know, how do you feel if you leave your phone behind?
Panic.
You know, you don't feel, you know, heartbroken, but you feel bereft at some level.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah.
Think about what you tell your phone. Your phone knows everyone you've been with,
yep.
All of your most intimate moments, who you're talking to, what you're saying. You know, it is already a machine with which we're sharing an awful lot of emotional content.
Yeah.
And then I think, you know, the last thing, we can talk about this more if you're interested, but I think the other area where we're going to see robots moving in the fastest is in assistive care. So we have a huge demographic shift going on where we're getting increasingly large numbers of elderly people without correspondingly large numbers of young people to help in their care. And so we are now, particularly in Japan, where this sort of the demographic shift has already is already underway, we're bringing in robots. You know, it's not the robot of the Jetsons who's walking around, you know, making your bed, but it's robots that are providing some means of emotional support. Robots like Fitbits, you know, this person has fallen and can't get up. This person has had blood levels go down. This person is having trouble breathing. And we'll all do that, just like we all get contact lenses if we need them and hip implants if we need them. And we will accept these robotic beings into our lives that way.
Yeah, I completely agree. And the other thing is, I feel like when people think about these robots and these relationships, they're extrapolating linearly from the technologies that now exist. And I think that we have to be open to the idea that the relationship that we have with robots won't necessarily be a second-rate relationship with another human. It may just be a first-rate relationship with a robot. I mean, lots of people have very intimate relationships with their pets, with their dogs. They're not calling their dog a second-rate human. It's just the dog.
It's something different.
Strengths and weaknesses and things that it does. And so you talk about elderly and how we're going to use those robots. But just imagine that these robots, we're going to have them like our phones, but they're going to be recording our entire lives.
They are already.
And over generations, so I'll have my iPhone is a little bit of a service robot, but I think that obviously it'll be much more. But 50 years from now, my grandchildren or whatever, they're gonna say, you know, show me so-and-so's 12th birthday. And so-and-so may be long gone. And so there's going to be an intimacy because these beings are going to contain all of our history, all of our knowledge. We're going to, in many ways, interact with the rest of the world, not through them, but in conjunction with them. And I think it's an intimacy that's different from a human intimacy, but I think it's a real intimacy. We won't think 50 years from now, oh, this is just what used to be a toaster, or this used to be a flip phone.
Well, and it's interesting. So when we were back in the pre-COVID days, when I was giving presentations about this, I always showed a picture of a robot that I talk about in the book. And it's a robot called Bina 48.
Mm.
And it's the animatronic version of a woman, a real woman named Bina, who's still alive, The robot's been built by her wife, who's a brilliant scientist. Mm-hmm. And the robot is being animated with all of the living Bina's digital ephemera. So it has her blog posts, her photos. And when I show this photo, and the robot only exists from sort of the torso up. And the last time I showed it, I was doing it on a Zoom call, and all of a sudden it struck me, we all look like Bina 48 now. So if you were a robot, I wouldn't know, because I'm seeing you, you know, from the neck up, and maybe you just are being animated in a very clever way. I can't really tell.
And we're restructuring our brains and our expectations, because there are lots of people. I know with me, I mean, Maddie referenced this One Shared World movement I started in the beginning of this year. I have like so many new, you know, they feel like close friends. I'm on Zoom calls with them every day. We're working really hard together. You know, there's people like you I've known for, excuse me, for decades. These are people I've never physically met.
Right.
And there's a real thing. And so now that we're socialized in that, and if we have the pixelation of that experience. So if we have, you know, the future version of ALEXA, I don't want her to respond.
Thank you.
The future version with a pixelate, with a image that's pixelated to the level of reality. And so we already have that technology where there just would be really no way to know the difference. I think we're going to socialize ourselves. This is a form of intimacy, and it's a real intimacy. It's not just a shadow of something else.
No, and you touch upon something that I talk about at the very end of the book, because I think it's not just our desire to sort of interact with people in different realms, different parts of the world. I think people are going to be eager, desperate to use some of these technologies to try to recapture some essence of people who have died. So when you're, and this is why this woman, Martine, is already trying to recreate her existing wife, because she doesn't want to lose her. Yeah. And sadly, I had a very dear friend who died this weekend. And, you know, the first thing I did was I got all the photos from my phone and, you know, made sure I had her texts. And again, this is Model T moment in history. But I'm sure, you know, her family, her husband, if, you know, if there was any way to capture her essence. And you know it's not her, right? You know she's gone. But can you capture some element of her memories, the way she texted? I mean, I'm sure my phone can mimic my texts. Yeah. It knows the emojis I send. Yeah. It knows the same words I use over and over again. You know, if I were gone and yet my phone could pretend to be me,
yeah.
You know, it's something. It's not the person, but it's something.
No, I definitely think it is. And that's why I think there are just these new ways of thinking. And I think for those of us who, you know, travel to places like Vietnam and other and China to a certain extent that have this tradition of ancestor worship and people who really believe in it, they really feel their ancestors are there. And it's going to be this very interesting, because right now, you know, we know kind of who our ancestors are, but it doesn't go back very far. We don't have that many records. I mean, we're going to be like our world is going to be populated by what our ancestors felt were these spirits that were very alive, but they'll be real. They'll be real presences. And again, if we're living remotely and your AI over the course of your life learns your kind of habits, kind of how you would respond. I just think that we're going to have so many of these different multiple realities around us. And that's why, and just to circle back and then open it up for questions, I think that's why your book is such an important one and why I hope everybody reads it, is that it's such a moment of profound change. And it requires us all to really take a step back and not just be linear thinkers, but just to imagine where the world is going to be. And there are lessons from history, but as you said, things are speeding up, and we almost have to suspend the regular working of our brain to be more creative in imagining where we're heading.
Yeah, and I think, and if I could just also sort of, you know, go with you in closing the loop, I think that's the underlying argument why I wanted to bring these two strands of literature together. Because, you know, if we assume, as I think you and I and most people would presume, the technology is going to happen, right? You can't stop it. You can't put the proverbial genie back in the bottle. But, you know, we already know we have to worry about what happens with automation and how these jobs get lost. And we have to worry about warfare as, you know, soldiers get replaced by drones. But if I'm right in saying that the technology is also going to disrupt our most fundamental intimate relationships, then let's at least give some thought to how we can harness the good side of these technologies and use them in ways that benefit humanity, rather than just, you know, letting Alexa get, you know, get all the goodies without us having anything to say about that progression.
Yeah, I think that's right. I think that, and that's why these kinds of conversations are so important, because everyone says, oh, the technology is great and it's going to solve everything, or it's terrible. And it's, I mean, sometimes it does end up killing us all, but it hasn't happened yet. I think that's what this is about, this moment, is how do we navigate? How do we become informed citizens and empowered citizens, so we're part of determining how this can be a good story? So yeah. Some great questions coming in the Q&A. Starting with the first question is, can you talk a little bit about how technology helped create the feminist movement? I mean, what were the interplays? It's actually this book and your last book together.
Yeah, so thank you for the question. I actually have a chapter in the book where I lay this out, and you know, I want to be careful in saying I don't mean to undermine the incredible work that feminist activists and advocates and legislators undertook, but feminism was really also made possible by, I argue, three core technologies. The first was the automobile, which gave women and everybody else a level of mobility that they hadn't had before. The second, more important, was household appliances. Mm. Jamie was talking earlier about the toaster, not the most important household appliances, but washing machines for sure, and refrigerators, which people rarely think of as sort of technologies of liberation, but I argue that they were, because prior to the advent of the washing machine, women spent tens of, you know, 10, 20 hours a week doing the family's laundry. It was completely onerous work. They spent hours and hours canning and preserving and going to the market and taking care of the chickens. Once you had refrigeration, you could go to the market once a week and put food in the refrigerator, and it didn't spoil, and you didn't have to worry about ice, and you didn't have to worry about canning or botulism. And so the household appliances really gave women the time, the actual, you know, physical, mathematical time to go out into the workplace if that's what they chose or needed to do. And then crucially, of course, the pill. Because with prior to the creation, the pill is a crucially important technology. The babies came when the babies came, and there was really very little a woman could do to control the number of children she had, much less time her children's births to coincide with her own economic or professional interests. Once you have contraception, women can separate sex from reproduction. And that's really the crucial technology that enables women to start to craft lives apart from their lives as wives and mothers.
So taking that again to another really great question, how do you feel that technology has changed the nature of community? I mean, we talked about this with virtualization. And how do you see that playing forward? And what's the interplay between the deep psychological need for a certain type of community and how we will navigate and negotiate how we get to keep that in this dramatically changed technological environment?
So I think this is one of the great lessons of COVID, which is that we need community. Hmm. You know, of all of the hundreds or thousands of people I've interacted with in some way since COVID started, there's only been one or two who said, gosh, this is great because I never have to see another human being again. I think we're all hungry for human interaction, whether it be at a bar or a street corner or a gym. We are a social species and we need that. If you look back in history, of course, our community was our village. Yeah. You know, we knew the people we lived with. Then it became sort of socioeconomic, where we went to college or where we worked. The question now is, as those places disappear, you know, if students aren't on campus, if employees aren't in the workplace, how will we remake community? And Jamie, you know, to pitch for you a little bit, I think you've already, you know, alluded that you started a whole new movement and you started it online. you know, I'm going to virtual fundraisers with people I don't know, for people I don't know. But I think we're doing that. We're, you know, it's a very small anecdote, but one of the few silver linings of COVID for me is I've reconnected with my fabulous New York book group. I had to leave them when I left New York, but now I can rejoin them again. So we will recreate community. And I think this is where, if we look back 10 years from now, we will say, wow, we actually were able to create more mindful, choice-based communities rather than just the people we happen to bash up against at the water cooler every day.
Yeah, and now that's the same thing. Is it in the beginning of these transitions, people are referencing the new thing and the old thing when you're one of those cusp generations who remembered the old thing. Like, oh yeah, like, you know, that's the horseless carriage parked in the driveway. People, whatever, our age and younger, it's a car. It's not a reference to the horse, that there's no horse. And I think that with these communities, it could be that we are all cusp generations who remember that old thing. And it also could be that this new virtualization, I mean, one shared world, it wouldn't have worked before COVID because we wouldn't have been able to find all of these people to rally. It would have been much more difficult to rally around a virtual community that they couldn't fully touch. And so there's something new that's happening. That's, even if there's a vaccine soon, which is probably unlikely, a vaccine that kind of solves the problem like polio, this stuff isn't going away. This kind of a new, it's just part of our new reality. So next, really great questions. Keep them coming. We've got about 15 more minutes. What surprised you most in your research?
Good. There are so many surprises. It's hard to find the one. You know, I'll think, you know, one of the chapters that doesn't come up very often, but I found it to be really interesting as I was doing the writing, was looking at the role of men and how men have been shaped by technology. Because, you know, my bias and my experience has been to be writing largely about women. And, you know, I think women's lives have changed more radically, certainly over the past 200 years than men's, as a result of contraception and entering the workforce and all these household appliances. But I think now we're at the cusp where men's lives are going to have to change as well. And that the force for that change is coming sort of from a reverse pressure, which is the jobs that are about to be wiped out by automation, truck drivers, factory workers, a lot of those jobs are held largely by men. Mm. And I, you know, was sort of following that logic through was something I just hadn't thought about very much. And I was stunned, although I shouldn't have been, to kind of realize that even though there have been lots and lots of people over the past 50 years writing about new identities for women and, you know, breaking down the old identity of women and giving them new forms, there's really not been that same kind of work applied to men. And I worry about that. I mean, I find it was fascinating as a researcher to stumble upon this, but it also really worries me, because unless we create sort of a whole range of new alternatives for men who aren't breadwinners, we wind up with revolutionary instincts. Yeah. And I think you're seeing that in this country. Men without jobs, men without an identity, yeah, and they become dangerous.
Yeah. Yeah. And it's hard. I mean, you were referencing it before. I mean, that there are just biological differences between men and women. And we talk about what are the types of things that robots in the nearer term aren't going to do well. I mean, it's a little bit stereotypical, but they aren't going to do things, for example, that great nurses do, or that great teachers do, or the kind of these jobs that are traditionally more, tend to be, at least here, more female, that are about connecting, that are about empathy. And for a lot of these, and it's not just truck drivers, it's radiologists, lawyers, a lot of these kinds of brute force analytical jobs are in some instances going to be more replaceable. And I think it's a really hard renegotiation.
Yeah.
So speaking of gender, and speaking of bias, because I know your mother, my parents, and your husband are all in this. So some guy named Miltos has a question about the end of life and how you see technology influencing how we think about death.
Right. So for those of you who don't know, Miltos is my husband, and this wasn't a setup, but thank you. So, and I think I can guess why he asked the question, because I was commenting to him earlier. You know, I've done a lot of these events and radio since the book came out, and everybody wants to talk about sex with robots. Everybody wants to talk about babies. And I haven't gotten a lot of interest, maybe because it's the last chapter in the book and people haven't gotten that far, to how technology is going to change the end of life. Right. And Jamie, you've done research on this too, but in many ways, these are the technologies that I found most interesting. And they're still all a little bit out there. Yeah. You know, they don't quite work yet, but there's kind of two different tracks on which people are working right now. There's a group of people I call the biohackers who are trying to change the underlying biology of we humans to make us live longer and theoretically even be immortal. You know, are there ways that we can re-engineer our cells so that our cells don't die? That's not going to happen in our lifetime, but I think it's starting to happen, or at least there are ways in which we can extend life far beyond sort of our current lifespans. And then at the same time, there are these people, one of whom is the woman who's doing the robot I was describing earlier, who are trying to find ways of sort of recreating the computers that are our brains so that our memories and our beings at some level can be reproduced. And if you start to put those two together, again, I'm not predicting immortality anytime soon. But I do think we will find ways of sort of fundamentally transforming, extending what we think of now as a normal lifespan. And, you know, and that too raises all kinds of more mundane questions. Our current sort of traditional structure is kind of based on the structure that assumed we would die at 40. Right. So we grow up, we become sexually active, we get married, we reproduce, we die. That's sort of the structure we have right now. If we live to 80, 100, 150, how would we want to rearrange those structures? I presume we would. I just don't know what that new form would necessarily look like.
Yeah, and again, it comes back to your point earlier about the speed of change. Nobody had to really ask the question, well, how will we change as a result of the agricultural revolution? Because in most cases, unless you just got conquered by, you were nomads who got conquered by agriculturalists, in which case it was fast. But for a lot of people, it was just this kind of slow thing. You planted a few crops, you had a new technology, it happened slowly over generations. And this is just going to happen much, much quicker. And so we're going to have to think it through and build structures and keep societies together.
And even just one little point on this, but it's already happening in our lifetimes. The technology of egg freezing has allowed a lot of young women to kind of fundamentally restructure their lives rather than saying, oops, you know, I really need to have babies before I'm 35. Women are saying, let me freeze my eggs. And, you know, if I haven't found the right guy or the right girl, I'll just wait. And again, this has become sort of mundane now, or, you know, it's sort of out there. Silicon Valley will, you know, subsidize it. But if you pause on that for a moment, it's just a massive technological change that people are essentially extending their fertile lifetimes solely as a result of technology.
Yeah, and that's with thinking of the kind of traditional way of what someone wants to do with their eggs. I write about this in my book, Hacking Darwin, of going into the sperm bank, and I say I want it freeze, and they went through all the checklists. Are like, are you having chemotherapy? Are you military being deployed? And no. And then they said, well, why do you want to do it? And I said, well, I'm thinking I may want to be the father of my great grandson. And I was kind of half kidding, and they just looked at me like I was a lunatic. And they said, well, how long do you want to store for? And I said, well, I'd like to start for 100 years, but if you have a 500-year plan, I'm willing to consider that. And it's just because, like, we're just assuming that we're going to use this technology to do what we're doing now more.
Right.
And I'm sure we will. But there'll also be a whole new other set of applications.
Right.
It'll just be using these basic ingredients, and it's like unlimited number of monkeys at an unlimited number of typewriters. Like, eventually people are going to come up with all new applications of putting these things together, and whether it's sending embryos on space missions to be reared by robots, or just so many other things. We don't have that much more time left, but somebody asked a really great question about the transgender community. I mean, that right now what we're seeing is that so many just realities can be shifted, and whether it's virtualization, where a lot of those kinds of physical just things that people are born with are much more malleable because the world is more malleable. How do you see the intersection of kind of multiple gender identities and technology?
So I think this is a really big deal. And this is another chapter in the book that hasn't gotten as much attention. I think because it's so complicated and sadly has become so controversial. But I think the transgender movement, if you will, is really important, not just for transgender people and those who want to support them, but for all of us. Because, as anyone who's listening or, is in their teenage years or, has children or people in their life who are teenagers, the generation coming of age now doesn't see the gender binary the way people of my age do. I was raised, as we all were, and, any of us, above a certain age, boys are boys and girls are girls and men, and there was no other option. There was nothing in the middle. And now, and again, because of technology, people can transition from one gender to another. They can remain in an in-between state. And as a result of that, and the publicity for both better and worse that has garnered, younger people and some older people who've accepted this just see gender as fluid. Yeah. The binary that we grow up with is just not in their minds. And as I say in the book, once the gender binary is gone, there's nothing to hold the future back. Because that, and I think that's why conservatives respond so irately to these transgender issues, because it's such a fundamental attack on these most basic constructs they have in their minds. Mm. And I think given in the current political climate, there will be setbacks, sadly, and people will be hurt as a result of it. But I think, again, that this trajectory is here. And whether it's the generation coming of age or their children, but in the near future, we will accept much more commonly that there is this fluidity of gender. And the fascinating footnote is the same woman who's creating Bina 48, the robot, this woman, Martine Rothblatt, used to be a man. She was Martin Rothblatt. Yes. And is absolutely brilliant. And as Martine will say, she says, look, I transitioned from man to woman and I'm still me. Why can't I transition from human to something else? She believes there's sort of a core identity.
Yeah, and I think you're right. And I think it's that the transgender community are just the pioneers of identity.
Yeah.
That it's not just gender that's malleable. Just so many of these things that our ancestors felt was fixed. And we talked about how long a life is, procreation, who you are, who you relate to. I mean, I think everybody... people are finding communities of people who are like them in some relevant way in some totally different part of the world. And yeah. I think it's such a tough issue because on one hand, if every aspect of life is fluid, a lot of people will get lost. And that's why we have traditional communities, we have religions. And I was in that old life of a few months ago. I was at the Vatican and they commissioned a report or commissioned a piece that I wrote on the future of human genetic engineering. But there's all of this tension because what is the Vatican in the business of? It's kind of like holding on. I mean, it's not that they don't change, but they change at the last possible minute. And yet this world of total fluidity is emerging. And yet the values that we need to navigate it wisely aren't necessarily new values, it's the application of old values. So what maybe last question, which somebody asked, is how do we think about this whole suite of values, of kind of taking our traditional values into this new world, including and particularly issues of equity and diversity?
So that's a really hard question, but it's a really important one as well, because, you know, Jamie, you touched on it at the very beginning. At this moment, when everything is changing so quickly, as a result of both technology and COVID and our, you know, massively disruptive political system, people need a set of values to hold on to. And one of the things that's happened, you know, to people sort of roughly my age is we've moved away from religion. And I don't know if that's a good thing or bad thing, but I think insofar as we have moved away from religion, we need something else. We need some replacement. We need some way of people not only just sort of learning these values, but reflecting upon them, internalizing them, and discussing them, and being part of a community that treasures them. And I don't think we have that right now. I think you see it strangely sometimes in the corporate environment, you know, trying to kind of recreate a sense of community and belonging and belief system. I don't think that quite works. I think those are important, but I don't think they substitute for a broader and more fundamental set of values. So I don't know how we come up with that. Yeah. But I have to say, I'm becoming increasingly convinced as I get older that we need that.
Yeah.
In this world. I was listening yesterday to a little video that was released by my now sadly deceased colleague, Clay Christensen, who was a star of the business school, star of the corporate world, and also a devout Mormon. And he's talking there about the importance of religion to capitalism. But the ending line, and I won't get it quite right, but he basically says, you know, without the Ten Commandments, you can never have enough police. And I think we're sort of seeing that now. Without some set of shared values, you can't have enough sort of violent force to get any kind of stability. So you know, I don't want to end on a pessimistic note, because ultimately, as you know, the book is pretty optimistic. But I think it does lead to some kind of call for coming together as communities, whether it be online book clubs or religious communities or neighborhoods, local communities, to start developing or at least hashing through or remembering some of these most basic values, because otherwise in this time of flux, they can get lost.
Yeah, and I think that's very optimistic, actually, because I think that to say these changes are happening and we have to understand them, we have to explore them, and then we have to say, well, how do we take this and build the kind of world that we want to live in? So everybody, including my parents and your mom, please, we hope that you'll get this book. The link is here. And read it and give it any review, between 4 and 6 stars on Amazon is fine. And tell your friends. I mean, these kinds of conversations aren't just entertainment. It's really how do we start constructing this kind of world. So, anyway, Deb, thank you so much. I don't know whether
thank you, Jamie.
No, of course, it was my pleasure. And then Maddie, over to you to close things out.
A huge thank you again to Deborah and Jamie for a wonderful night in. Thanks to all of you out there too for spending your evening with us. And you can learn more and purchase tonight's book, as Jamie said, Workmate Their Merry Love, through the link in the chat box. And on behalf of Harvard Bookstore here in Cambridge, Mass, have a good night, keep reading, and please be well.